Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to day one of the four-day project development boot camp on React.js, organized by the Computer Society of India, KJSIEIT. Our college, KJ Somaiya Institute of Engineering and Information Technology Science, has been accredited by NAC with an A grade and was awarded the best college by the University of Mumbai for academic year 2018-19 Urban Region, CSI Mumbai Chapter, and ISTE Maharashtra and Goa Section. I would like to thank Professor Uday Rote Sir, Dean of Students Welfare, our Principal Dr. Suresh Akarande Sir, and Vice Principal Dr. Sunita Patil Ma'am for giving us this opportunity to organize this bootcamp and for all their support. Today, we have our very own software admin, Mr. Mitanshu Reshamwala, as the speaker for this series. Mitanshu Reshamwala is a final year computer engineering student at KJSIEIT. He is an AI enthusiast with data analysis, data visualization, machine learning, and deep learning as a part of his large skill set. He has also worked as an AI engineer for the Indian Meteorological Department. He has participated in various hackathons and worked on multiple projects, gaining proficiency in various web development frameworks and platforms such as React.js, React Native, Node.js, making him the perfect person to deliver this four-day bootcamp. We will now start with the session. Over to you, Mitanshu.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mitanshu Reshamwala, and I'm going to conduct this webinar on React. So first, about me, I am a final year computer engineering student at KJ Somaiya Institute of Engineering and IT. So some of the projects that I personally have built using React is, I had built a dashboard for power consumption with Tata Power and IMD both. Then I had created for our college, KJ Somaiya, I had created two softwares, which were Canteen Automation System and Exam Software, which is close to completion. And I have created multiple personal projects too, one of which I will show the demo after the PPT. So first, I would like to ask every one of you, what do you think is React? People can unmute themselves, or they can put it in the chat box.
A web development framework for designing the UI.
Yes, and
JavaScript library.
Yes, it is a library. What else?
Yeah, single page application
for dynamically loading data.
Yes.
So mobile application.
Mobile application is using React. So Facebook open source team, they developed another software from React.js itself. Is called React Native, which they use to build applications. So React.js specifically is not used for building application, but it is, both of them are very similar. There is one very important feature that all of you are missing, other than just displaying the UI. Anyone?
It is open source.
No, open source, all of that is yes, but I'm talking about like React, the software itself. The features that itself
it dynamically loads the components based on the state.
It's a single page application.
Yes. All of you are very close. So, this is the official definition of React. So React, it is a JavaScript library, and this library has only two uses. One, it creates reusable UI components. So back then, Facebook, they had their whole application built in PHP. There was a lot of repetitive code, and there were only like minor differences. So they created this concept of components, which gave them a lot of power to build their websites. The second, and this is what makes React special, is it only reacts. to the data changes that happen. So let's say that there is a page title. So it will, if there is some changes from the database that is coming, that the React software will only react to those changes. The rest of the pages won't re-render. So this gives you a lot of performance boost for your website. We will look into it as we go through our bootcamp. Okay, so you will understand these two points very clearly. Okay, so why are we learning React? The only reason is currently in the web development job market, React is the most popular library that is used for creating websites. So anyone can like tell me any companies that use React, some examples?
Instagram.
The Facebook, Facebook, yes. Facebook, Netflix, Twitter. Right? Yes.
Discord.
Discord, I'm not sure, but it might be using. YouTube, no. YouTube, so YouTube is from WhatsApp. Google, right? So, WhatsApp. All the Facebook applications, definitely they use React in some...
Dropbox.
Huh?
Dropbox.
Yes, Dropbox.
Skype.
Amazon, no, and YouTube, no. So, YouTube uses Angular. That is another library created by Google. Okay, so I guess you all of you know a lot of applications that are being built. So these are some examples that I listed: Facebook, Netflix, Airbnb, Dropbox. So you can see all these like big Fortune 500 companies are using something like React. Okay, so let's get to the core concept that we are going to cover in this 4-day bootcamp. Okay, so people who are more familiar with JavaScript, they might know that there is something called as a DOM on your web page, which is document object mapping, right? So React has its own virtual DOM, which, as I said, that React only reacts to the data changes. It won't re-render the whole page. So how does React do that? It does this through React DOM. We will see that in detail, okay? Then React has its own like different language in which it is written, which is called as JSX, and it is kind of like a hybrid between JavaScript and HTML. Okay, then in coding, people have learned C++, Java, Python. You might be aware about like what variables and data types are, right? What are variables? These are just like placeholders that you can keep on using again and again, right? So same goes, React itself, you can think of it like a language itself. And components are your variables and props are the values that are passed to it, okay? I'm giving an analogy so that people who know a little bit of coding can relate to it. Then you have your state and life cycle. As I said, changes in data is an integral part of React, okay? So all these changes, so in coding, you might write C is equals to A plus B. Similarly, over here also, there are some life cycle events when the page is opened, or the page is closed, or some data has come from the database. These are different lifecycle events. So according to that, the state of the page, so currently how the page should be, that changes. And whenever that state changes, React will say, okay, you need to re-render these things, okay? Then event handling, and like you clicked the button, you typed something, all of these things, then you might have learned about if and else in languages, conditionals. So if a condition is true, do something or else do something. Similarly in React also, you might say that, let's say there's a nav bar and you want that if I'm logged in, it should show me the output of sign out. Otherwise, I'm not logged in, so it should show me the option of login, right? You shouldn't show both of them. So that happens through conditional rendering. Then you have your list and keys. You can relate that to like for loops, while loops, that let's say there is a big menu. There are a lot of items in that menu, right? And you want to show all of them. So as I said, components give you a lot of power, right? So you can create one component that specifies one item of that list, and you can create that same element again and again with different properties passed to it, okay? And then there's your form handling. There's a form you need to submit something. So these are the things we are going to cover across these 4 days. Okay. Now, what are we going to build? So today, we are going to build a very simple counter app. It's not very complex, but it will teach you all the basics that are required. Okay. Tomorrow, we are going to build a to-do list application. So you might, all of you might be using some kind of note-taking app. My favorite is Google Keep. So we will be building some kind of similar note-taking app where you can add your notes, delete your notes, take it that it is completed or not. And we will be integrating Firebase data. It's a database, Firebase, with our application. And then we will be hosting it on the cloud. So I personally believe that if you have built something, everyone should see it. It should be on the cloud for everyone to interact with. Okay. So our to-do list app, social media website, and e-commerce website, all three of them are going to be hosted on the cloud. Okay. The third application, which will be on next Saturday, we will build a social media website. In that, we will learn how to handle authentication, how to handle different users. Right. Then in that, we will be also learning how to handle images. So you know how to handle a small data with database. Some of you are like college students. So you all have experience with MySQL or MongoDB or some database like that. Right. Similarly, we are going to but the images. Images have to be handled differently. So that is something that we're going to learn in that. Then e-commerce website, okay? We are going to practice all of the concepts that we have learned again, but the one thing that we will be learning is e-commerce websites, they are a very big website. So in that, how to handle data across such a big application. So there is something called a state management, which is your data overall on a global state. So that is something that we will be learning on e-commerce website. Okay. So that's it for the agenda. Now, first thing that we are going to do is we are going to download a few requirements that we need. First thing, Node.js, I'll put this in the chat box. Okay, payment gateway. We might, if we have, because the e-commerce website is a very big application, that if we can have, we do have the time to do it, we will add Razorpay. Okay, we will try doing that if we can do it early. So first thing, the only requirement is you need Node.js. That's the only requirement for this course. And any text editor that you want, I'll be using Visual Studio Code. So I'll put the link for that too. You can download using these two links. These are very simple installations. It's just next, next, next. So after all of you are done, you can say yes or downloaded. Everything is ready. How do you check if it is done? Open your command prompt or terminal and just write Node. Okay. So it should say welcome to Node.js, something like that. And you can exit using Control C. Okay. So after everyone has done downloading Node.js, and any text editor, if you already have one, well and good. We
will you please put a Node.js link in chat box?
I have put it in the chat box.
Sorry, but I didn't receive it. Can you please repost it?
Oh, okay. I'll repost it. Okay, I reposted both the links. Can now everyone see this? Okay, are we going to learn routing using React Router? Yes, we are going to use that. Okay. Everyone download Node 14 because that is the stable version. Okay, I said that I will be showing a demo of some kind of application. So this is an application that I personally have built for my mini project for the college. So this is just an Airbnb clone, right? So you can add a listing as a host. You can look at all the listings that someone else has posted on the application, and you can look at each and every listing. So this is just an example of what you can do. This is a very simple application, but you can see that and all of this is hosted and on Firebase, and anyone can use it. Anyone wants to go check it out for themselves, they can look at this. Do you want me to put this link in the chat box?
Yes, please.
Yes, please. Yeah.
You can check it out over here. Yes, okay. The recording will be provided. Yes. Okay, so what is Node.js, right? So what Node.js is, basically anything that you run on your browser, it has something running on the side in the background. There is something that you're looking at. So this all is called UI, user interface, that what you're looking at, right? But behind, let's say I click this button, it is opening an download page, or it is redirecting me to somewhere, or as you can see, it opened this download executable file, right? How does that happen? And behind the scenes, this is running some JavaScript code, right? So some of you that might have practiced a little bit of JavaScript, they might be aware there is something called as a console on the browser. So over here, I can run some code. So let's say 2 + 3, this is 5, a very basic, but this is JavaScript, what is being run, right? Everyone please answer this poll also, so that I know how much experience everyone has. And we use Django with React. Yes. So, okay. I was explaining. So what Node.js does is, right, that Node.js will provide you this JavaScript environment. Okay. So Node.js has taken Chrome's JavaScript runtime environment, and it has taken it into a, it has converted into a file that you can run, on which you can run your JavaScript code and test it. You don't need a browser for that. Okay. So that is what it has done. So in Node.js, you can build your backend, you can build your front end, even you can do like machine learning also. There is now possibility to do machine learning also using JavaScript, using Node.js. So that's why you might have seen that back in 2013 era, that web development took such a like increase in popularity, is because 2010, that era, because that's when Node.js was launched. So you might have seen that a lot of application got way more powerful because they got access to the JavaScript environment, like right in their machines. So be it your personal laptop or a server, okay? So I think this is enough. So I'm seeing that most of 90% are beginner, and there's only 1% who is advanced. So you also have something new to learn over here. We will be integrating with Firebase. So that is one new thing that you'll be learning. And if you don't know how to do image handling, that's something that you will learn over here. But okay, so I can see majority are beginners. So I will try to explain everything in a very simple fashion. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So basically what React is, it just creates a it creates your website using this Node.js environment, right? So there are like basic commands. Okay, so React, when we are running it in a development mode, okay, so there will be a local server that will be running, which will be executing all of your React code. Okay, but when you build the project, okay, React creates, as someone had said in when I had asked what is React, someone said that React creates single page applications. Okay, so people who are familiar with HTML, CSS, they might know that when you launch a page, it is a HTML page that is being rendered to you, right? So what to type? You type, or just you type node in the command prompt. Where's my node? Yes, just type this. And if you get a message like this, welcome to node, any version, preferably please download the 14 version. So if this message comes, your installation is proper. Okay. Huh. So I was saying that, okay. Yes. You can use that also, node version, that command also you can run. Right. So, so what React will do when you build the project, it will create an one index.html file and whatever JavaScript files are required, it will create a minified version of it, a very compressed format of all your code. And what will happen that it, I will just show you how a build folder looks like. Yes, so it just contains your index.html, one HTML file, some assets, or there might be different let's say like your favicon here, or your logos, and over here your CSS and JavaScript files. So that's what it does. So the HTML file in itself is empty. Sorry, I shouldn't open this one. Yes. Okay. What this HTML file is, it's actually an empty HTML file, which is the same as this file. This will be easier to look at. Yes. It just has all these like header tags, right? And the body is empty and it has this one div, which has the ID of root. You please remember this ID of root because we will discuss this right now. Okay, that's all. The page is empty on its own. There is nothing going on. What the JavaScript files that you saw in the build folder, they are the ones that are going to fill this HTML file and add data into it. Okay, now this is going a little bit in depth on how exactly React handles everything. You don't need to know all of that as of right now. Okay. Error received. Upgrade. Don't install Visual Studio. I said Visual Studio Code. Both are different softwares. This one is Visual Studio Code. You might have installed Visual Studio. Our website is responsive, but for that you have to make it responsive. It's not responsive like by default. You have to write CSS for it. You need to style it in a way. Yes, so because these are static files, the build folder creates static files. So you use any backend, be it Django, be it Laravel, it can connect with anyone. Okay. Be it in like Golang or Java. Java, I think Java has Spring for their backend. So all of that can serve static files. So React, when you build a React project, it will create static folders so you can use. Is Node.js first? No. So what Eclipse is a IDE, integrated development environment. Whereas Node.js, it is a runtime. So how you write, you run Java using Java and the file, whatever name, right? Similarly, you use Node to run all of this. Yeah, Java runtime environment, yes. Eclipse, I can say that it is similar to VS Code. VS Code is a text editor, not a IDE. But now it has so many features that it is kind of like an IDE now. Okay. I think we can start now. So this is the application that we are going to be building today. It's a very simple app. It's just a counter app. When you click on plus, it will add the value over here. And you click minus, it will subtract it, right? And you can change this value. So let's say if it is 1, it will add 1. I think it was clear like what's going on in this application, right? So we will start building this application. So first thing that you need to do is done with installation. Extensions in VS Code, yes. I will be discussing that. There are one or two extensions that we'll be using in VS Code, but there's no issue if someone is using any other one. It's okay because those extensions are just for increasing our efficiency in coding. We will be using functional components because now whatever new projects are being made, they're being made using functional components. There is no difference feature-wise between functional and class components now. Class components is kind of like a legacy code now. Most of your companies are shifting from class to functional components because there are some features that functional can provide that class cannot. For those who are like learning it for the first time, you don't need to know what is difference between functional and class component. Okay, because we are just going to be focused on functional components. Okay, so I think now I will like start the application. Okay, so first, open any like folder where you want to run this thing. Okay. And you can open, so I'm on Windows, so if I just write cmd over here, it will open the command prompt with the address over here. So wherever you want to make the project, just open the command prompt or terminal over there. Okay. Right. And then you have to run this command, npx create react app. And you can name it anything. If you want like proper or you don't want to have any spelling mistake, you can go to the React.js website, official website. And I'll put this link over here. Create a new React app. Yes, this is the command that we need to run. I'll put this link in the chat box. I can put a little bit of Hindi, but like I have like it is like come to my notice that some people are also attending this internationally, so I cannot do that for that reason. So this is the link that I have sent in the chat box where you can find this command if you just don't want to make any spelling mistakes. Create React app and you can name it anything. I'm just going to name it counter. Okay. What this is going to do is going to create a folder over here with the same name counter, okay, over here. And then it's going to install different packages that are going to be required for our project. So this will take a couple of minutes. So when everyone has done installing everything, it will say happy hacking. Whenever you see that message, that means it's done. So everyone can let me know at that point. Muzamil, which node version are you using? Who put the error of npx not? Rohit. What node version are you using? Because if you're using node 14, which is like the latest stable version of node, you shouldn't get that error of npx.
I just installed it using the link which you provided.
Okay. Did you put anything like before it or after it? If you put the command exactly as this, exactly like this, there should not be any problem.
Okay, I'll check.
Yes. This will be put on YouTube later on. Are you using Linux? Because if you're using Linux, you need to add node to the path. So that might be one issue. If you're using Windows or Mac, everything is just like done for you by the installer.
Yeah, it's Windows only.
Okay. Then there shouldn't be any issue. Or you can just try it again and let me know. As you can see, like this will take a little bit of time because React itself is a little heavy. And it depends on your internet speed. If your node is not like added to the path, did that node command give you that welcome to node version, whatever that output? If it gave that, then there shouldn't be any problem. Command not from, you need to write npx before create React app. If that skipping optional dependencies, all that message will be given by the node. In that runner which is installing, creating this project for you, that's what is doing all of that for you, so you don't need to worry about that. In the end, it should just give you a message that everything is done successfully, happy hacking, a message will come. So if that if you get that message, then everything is proper. If it gives any error and it stops running, so then there is some problem.
Will you please show the command you put in command prompt?
Someone just put it. I'll put it again. Prasukh has put the command. I'll again paste that command in the chat box. Yes, as you can see, I got the message of happy hacking. For those who are done creating the project, you can just open the folder in VS Code. Over here, you can see that all of these files have been put by the installer right now. I'll just open this in code, or you can just open the code and open VS Code and open this folder as of this page. Okay, open it. I'll just check if anyone else has any problem. If you're getting no error, the operation not permitted, so maybe it might be happening that you don't have permissions for this thing. Are you using Linux, Atharva Kadam? Rohit, I couldn't see your photo. I don't know, it's not opening. Can you just send it again? I tried opening the file, but I can't seem to find it. Okay, I found it. Not recognized. Did your installation happen properly for Node?
Yes, it did. I think.
Then the error shouldn't come. Okay, so what files and packages are created? So first, this is a template. So create React app. When you run this command, it will install all of these files over here. Okay. There will be a README on how to work with this project. So you can read this and understand a little bit on how React works. Then you have your package.json. So those who have worked with JavaScript very much, they might know that package.json is the entry point. So in Java, how your main package and main function is the entry point to the program. Similarly, you can think that package.json is the entry point. Everything that happens is happening through package.json. And these are different source code. They have a sample code. This is just a template, boilerplate code that you can run. And this is the public folder. So over here, I said that the index.html file. So this is the page that will be displayed. And in this div, inside this div, your application will be injected. So we will see that in detail. And there's a node modules folder. So over here, you will find all your packages that you will be using. So JavaScript is very notorious in installing a lot of dependencies, as you can see. Over here, you will find there is something called as React in this node modules. Okay. Would not install path, does not contain a package.json file. If you are also, that might be an issue is because when you're running this command, right? Where did we run this? We ran it in our React Bootcamp folder. And then our project is created in React Bootcamp /counter. So as you can see over here, it is said that first we need to change our directory into the counter folder, and then you do npm start. Otherwise, you will get that error that package.json doesn't exist, because as of this folder, it can't find any package.json. I said package.json is your entry point. Okay. What is npm? Okay, so npm is your node package manager. So in Python, I'm very familiar with Python. So there's something called as pip. In Java, I'm not aware in Java. In Golang, Golang doesn't have any. I know in Python. So Python, you have your pip manager. So similarly, what npm does is you can write npm install some package, and there is an npm registry. So from there, you can install these external dependencies that some other software, whoever has created this, someone has created this, open sourced it, people can use it. So that you can download it for yourself and use it. Okay, after searching, it said to install npm. Can you say what your error is? Unexpected identifier. Can you explain what did you run? My project is my app counter. Okay, so you can put any name. So React has this naming convention that the name of the project should be lowercase, no spaces. You can put hyphens, underscores. You can't put capital. So if you put counter with a capital C, that will give you an error. So these are some sort of errors. For right now, you can just write counter as I have written so that you don't face any error. Okay, done with creation, very good. You can put my app counter, that also you can do. You need to install, npm comes with node. You don't need to install it separately. npm error, okay. the session we thank for okay so if anyone is facing any like installation doubts, you can like watch this part later on YouTube. So right now I'll just go ahead with our application. So everyone has opened this folder in VS Code. Now everything we will do is in VS Code and the browser. There will not be anything else that we'll be doing. So VS Code has a built-in terminal. So over here, we can run all our commands very nicely. So we'll just write npm start. Okay. What this is going to do, you can check package.json. Okay. So over here, you will find everything that our project is doing. So this all we don't care. Dependencies. These are the packages that we are using while we created this project. So you can see that we are using the React library and the specific version, right? So similarly, these are other dependencies that Create React app gives us. Okay, then these are the scripts that we can run. So as you saw right now, we ran npm start. So what this does is it will start a development server. Okay, as you can see now in the terminal, it's showing that we started a development server, which is going to open our application. It's going to run our application. Then the second command is build. I showed you that it will create a minified version of all your code. So that's what build does. It will create a build folder in which all your files will be compressed and there will be JavaScript files which will be injected into your application. Testing and ejecting is ejecting is something that's very advanced. People should not do it unless they know what they're doing. Never run this command unless you know what you're doing. Testing, if there are some kind of tests that you have put on your code, so you can run this command to run all of that. So in JavaScript, you can use jest. So this is by default you get when you run Create React app, this is something that you get by default. Using jest, you can run some tests on your code. We won't be covering test in this. If you want, you can add it in your feedback form that if you want some seminar or webinar on jest testing itself, like testing library for React. Okay, what is the difference between npm and npx? So there used to be npm and npx had differences. Or right now, we don't need to worry about it. Okay. Advantages of React over Flutter. Okay, so when you say React, you're saying React Native. That is different. React Native is more mature, but I think that's like off topic. And if you want, you can like message me on LinkedIn or something where I can explain this in detail. The commands that I run, I just ran npm start. That's all I did. This is the command that I run. Okay, you might have seen it in the terminal when you created the application, this command npm start. That's the command that I've run. Okay, so it shows that it has compiled successfully and we can see it in our browser. This is a default app that Create React app provides us. Okay, so first thing that we are going to do is we are going to remove all of this. Okay, so everything happens in the source folder. Okay, the entry point is index.js file. So I said React DOM. Okay, what React DOM does is all your application, I'll just inspect the page and show how the page looks now. So this is our body and this is the div. If you remember our index.html, this file, inside div, it's empty. There's nothing in here. It's empty, right? And over here, you can see now there is so much stuff that is present inside it. Right. So how this happened? These files, they have injected it into our web page, into the HTML file. Okay. How React DOM works explicitly, that is a very advanced topic, but the only thing that you need to know is that when you use React DOM, you first get an element. So we got it by ID. So this is just a this is basic JavaScript, document.getElementById. And we found the root element. And inside that, we are injecting our code. Okay, so that's what React DOM does.
Okay. Which is file extension for JS or JSX. Both are fine. It can be JS or JSX. Both are fine. There is no like preference.
Okay. Okay. Now we will go to our app. So this is where all our code is. Okay. So you can see that we are importing. First, we are importing some logos and some static files. This is not important. What for this does is, this is JSX. You can see that this all is HTML, but I'm writing it in a JavaScript file. So this is what I said, that it's a hybrid of JavaScript and HTML. So we'll just try doing some changes over here. So let's say hello, everyone. And one feature of Create React App is that it gives you hot reload. So as soon as I saved the file over here, it showed me the changes on the browser. Okay, so first things first, we are going to just remove all of this. Everyone is now familiar with how React DOM works and what is JSX, right? So we'll just start building our application. So you can see what our application looks like. What do we need? We need a button, two buttons. One for plus, one for minus, a value that displays the current value, what we are showing, and some value with which we want to change. So first, we are not going to worry about this. We are going to just deal with one, like plus minus one we are going to do. We'll just make this three elements, okay? So what you need to do is remove all of these files, app.css, app.test, then logo, this report, setup test, remove all of these files. From app.js, or remove these two lines, remove both of them. Remove this whole div and just put an empty div in here. Okay. And over here, yes, remove this line and this section. Okay, so we have stripped down our code. Now if I see the browser, it should not. Yes, now it's just a blank page. There is nothing that is being shown on the page. Okay, okay, what we need to do? Okay, have these three files, index.js, index.css, and app.js, and app.js needs to be empty. From index.js, remove report vitals line, and over here this line where you're importing it, remove that also. These two lines you need to remove from here. Everyone's caught up? Basically, your browser should look blank and it should compile successfully. There shouldn't be any errors.
App.js mein kya changes karne?
App.js basically upar ka sab import nikal do, remove all of that and just return an empty like div. That's all. Nothing else.
After doing npm start, I got an error, npm error, code invent.
That usually happens, or you can just restart, or you can, over here, there is something called as dustbin button, so that will kill your terminal. You can just try restarting your terminal, so that should solve the error. If not, you can just tell me again. Okay. Okay, nobody has any doubts, so I'll just continue now. Okay, so first thing, as I showed in the application, that we need one button, one label to display the values and a minus button. Okay, so this is going to be just an basic HTML only. There is nothing like fancy going on over here. There will be a button and that will have like plus on it. Then there is just a P tag, which will have some value, let's say 10. And then there is another button, which has minus on it. Okay. So as you can see now, this is like in a corner, all these three things are displayed. We'll add some styling to it so that it's on the center of the screen. This is just CSS. Now what I'm going to do is not something that's very complicated. It's just basic CSS. Okay, add this property called class name to your div. Okay, we will create a file called as app.css. Okay, and we will create a class called app, which will have the following styles. These ones I'm putting in the chat box because I don't think like CSS is required that I need to teach you. I'll just put this CSS in. So what this is going to do is, I'll just show it on the browser.
You have not imported the file in app.js.
Right. Sorry. And also wrap this whole thing in another div. And save. And this will have a class name of counter. So what we are doing right now is just like styling our application so that it's in the center of the screen. Over here, there is nothing like interesting going on. Yeah, now everything is in the center, right? What we did, I'll just tell again. I created a file called app.css and I put these two lines. You can find these in the chat box. I have put it over there. So you don't need to write it again. Next, what I did was I wrote these lines. So this is basic HTML. I created an HTML, which will put this whole thing in the center of the screen. And next, I put all of these buttons and labels, which will be displayed. And this counter class will just make everything look in a row. That's all, with some spacing. Everyone's over here. Can I see a few? Yes, like send the counter styling as well. Oh, I have put, I'll just put it again. I've again put it in the chat box over here. Everyone can see. Okay, so like how everything is happening. Okay, in JavaScript you have like your three sections. First you import some things. So over here I have imported the stylings. I have written in app.css. Okay, then this is the JSX part. This is where our application is being run. Okay, I will explain how what everything is happening over here. And we are exporting this whole section, whatever we are doing, to our index.js, which will render all of this. Okay, so this is how everything is happening. The app itself is a component. Okay, app is a component. We will see what an component is in 2 minutes. But this is how everything happens. Everyone is clear till here? Yes, what changes? You can just look at the files. I have put both of them in front. So you can see what changes I have done. What the output should be is just these two buttons and this label over here showing 10 on the screen. That's all. Make sure to save both the files. Otherwise, you won't see the changes. Yes, you can do it in Android Studio too. That's no problem. You can do it, but I would suggest React.js. Okay, if you're using React.js, there are a few extensions that I would suggest you should put. First one is ES7, React Redux. So this one, as you can see, this is by this guy, DSZ Najder. You can, this is a very good extension. You can put this one. And another one is called Prettier. These two, this is just a code formatter. As you saw, like when I was coding it, put everything in a nice format. So it's just for that. These two are optional. If you want, you can put. Otherwise, it's okay if you don't. This is a convention that whenever you're creating a component, okay? Whenever you're creating a component, the first letter should be capital. There is something called as Pascal case. So what Pascal case is that every word should have the first letter as capital. Then you have your camel case. This is something that we'll be using for naming our functions. Okay, so inside if you're writing something and there are like, let's say point or submit form, so something like that. So we will write this in camel case. So these are just conventions. Right now you don't need to worry about conventions, but yes, the app, this one should be capital. Okay. In Python you write something called as like snake format. I don't know the perfect name, but this is how you write it in Python. This you won't see in JavaScript. Okay. Okay, so I'll like move forward now. Okay, so now we'll explain like how everything is being run. So there is a function called as app. Did someone have any doubt? I heard someone unmute themselves.
How to run app in terminal?
You want to run app in terminal? Okay.
मैंने जब npm start किया ना तो वहाँ पे error दिखा रहा था.
Right. And what's the error? I told you to delete a few files. I think you might have not done that. I just need these 4 files. Okay. From index, you need to remove this line, report vitals line. Okay. And over here also, there might be a function that's calling the vitals. So remove that.
Yes, I deleted that.
And in app.js, you might be importing a few things that you deleted just now to remove all of that. Okay.
Yes, I removed that, but then it's showing that npm, the term npm is not recognized as the name of cmdlt.
You might have some installation. You can contact me later if you have any installation right now. I need to move forward.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So I will now move forward. Okay. What this does is, okay, everyone, if I'll just again show the names of the extensions if you require these. Okay. What this does is React DOM will render this component into this root element. Okay. We saw it in index.html. I'll close this file now. So it will first find this div, right? We'll find this element which has the ID of root. That's what this line is doing. Okay. You can read the documentation over here. And what is it going to put inside this? It's going to put this component. You don't need to worry about strict mode right now. That's something that's a little advanced, but it's okay. What it's going to do, whatever this component is returning, as you saw, what are we returning? We're returning this HTML, right? HTML code. It's going to put this HTML code in this root element over here, which we can see it in our browser now. Our head inside the root, you can see first we have our app class, right? You saw it over here. First we have our app class division, and inside that we have our counter, right? And inside that we have our buttons and this paragraph, right? So that's how React renders everything. And let's say I change it from 10 to 11. If you will see, it just changed this part. Was it too fast? Should I show it again? When I change this file, you saw it's going to only update the paragraph tag and the value in it. It didn't change anything else, right? So as I said, it will only react to changes. It won't re-render the whole page again. Whereas in PHP, if you might know that every time you you go to some different page, everything happens that your whole page is reloading again. Whereas in this thing, it's going to just remove this 10 and it's going to add an 11. That's what's happening over here. Okay. That's what that's how React's virtual node works. Okay. Okay, everyone. Okay. Sorry, I accidentally deleted the div. Sorry. Okay, now the first thing that we're going to learn is state. Okay. There is something called as useState that is provided using React. So I told to install the extension. So that's what's giving me this snippet. Okay, the one with the hollow box, that's the snippet. It will add this whole line for me. And let's just say counter value. That's the name of this, whatever we are going to display over here. And initially I give it a value of 10. Also, we need to import this that's coming from React. Okay. Okay, let's understand what's happening. First, we are importing the React library that we're using. We are importing something called as useState. In React, this is called as hooks. Okay. What this hooks provide us is a functionality. It returns a stateful value and a function to update it. So this is where we track any changes that happen in our file. So right now, if I try to change from 10 to something else, it won't happen in the rest of page because it doesn't know that where this 10 is coming from. Okay. This useState, it will return two things. So first, the counter value. Okay. This will be, or you can say it's just read only, and set value is like a write only. It's not exactly that, but you can think of it like that. Yes. Anyone was saying something? Okay. So this variable we are going to put over here. Sorry. Copy. Paste. Okay. Now you can see once I'll save this. Oh, it just displayed counter value. What happened? Anybody knows what happened over here?
To use a JavaScript value, we need to wrap it in curly braces. It just printed the text.
Right. Okay. So for some for the others like who didn't know what happened is that when I wrote this counter value, it saw this as something a proper like a text that you want to display on the file. Like when you're writing HTML, you put something over here, and if you put it in a p tag. What does it do? It will display some text directly, right? So that's what it's doing. It doesn't know that counter value is some like variable in the JavaScript part. So whenever you are writing some JavaScript inside the HTML part, so you always return the HTML part, okay? So whenever you want to write some JavaScript there in it, you need to wrap it with curly braces, okay? Now VS Code, it's my text editor, it's showing me, oh, that it changed its color to blue, so it knows that, okay, this is now JavaScript. And when I hover on it, it highlights the actual value, so it shows me where it's coming from. So this is some like features that your ID or text editors will tell you that what's happening. But you also need to know that how everything is happening, right? Because sometimes brackets can get very confusing, okay? So inside these curly braces, whatever I put, it has to be a JavaScript code. Okay, so when I put counter value, it reads the value that is in this variable. And what is the initial value that I give is 10. So when I save this file and I look at the browser, now I can see the value 10. Is this clear as of right now? Can you zoom in? Okay. Is this okay? Is this okay now? Use state is not defined. Yeah, you need to import it from React because this is something that React provides to us. That's why we need to import it. Which extensions? I installed two extensions, Prettier and ES7 React snippets. So that's just basically like, I don't need to write this whole thing. I can just write use state and I can give it some name, let's say ABC, and it will just give me like easy way to write all of this. That's all, it's just convenience. You don't need to do it. You can do it without also. You just need to write the whole thing, right? Okay. Okay, I'll move forward. So you might have noticed that this whole thing, we need to write it in camel case. All right. So counter value, these are two different words. So the first letter is small. And when I came to V, it has to be capital. This is just convention that people need to follow. Set, then counter is a new word. The C should be capital. Okay. Now we will see how to change this value. Right, we have this 10. Now how do we change it? When we click on this button, nothing's happening, right? So now we need to add some functionality into it. How do we do that? So button, it has a property called as onClick. Okay, so onClick, and I need to write some JavaScript code. So you can see I put the curly braces. So very basic, what do? Whenever we want to check how everything is working, we will like print it out. So we'll just console log this thing that clicked, right? Now I'll just open the console log on the side. Yeah. Whenever I'm clicking this, okay. I think my server crashed. Okay.
You didn't make it a function.
Sorry. I need to pass it a function that will console log. Okay, so what happened over here? What mistake I did? Okay, does anyone know what mistake did I do?
the onclick parameter expected as a function, and you passed a statement. So it executed it, and thus there was no other change on onclick.
Right. So what I did was I gave it an expression, right? So when I put this thing, so you can see it initially it ran the command, but whenever I'm clicking it, it's not happening. Why? Because onClick requires a function. Okay, it needs a handler. You can see this is some like help that my ID or my text editor is providing me, that it needs some sort of a handler, right? So what a handler is, it is just a function that is going to be called. So in JavaScript, this is how you write a function using this parameter, then an arrow, and inside the curly braces, you can put your code, okay? This is the syntax of writing a function. There's a different syntax also, but I'm going to be using this syntax whenever I use a function. Okay, you're free to use the other syntax. So by default, this is written in the old syntax of writing a function. Function, its name, parentheses, and inside the bracket, the code. Okay, it's the same thing, just a different way of writing it. You're free to choose any one of them. Okay, so now we can, now whenever we are clicking, we are printing out that we click the button, right? Now over here, I will add some functionality to add one to the value, right? So how will I do that? I'm going to call this set value function. As you can see, it returns a stateful value, which we used over here, right? And the second thing, what does it return? A function to update it. So this is a function, okay? So whenever you're writing a function, we need to pass some value using round brackets, okay? And you can see this is the IntelliSense that's telling me that it requires a value in it, okay? Now what should be the value? Let's say 11. Okay, I clicked it. It changed to 11. I again clicked it. Okay, now it's not changing. Why is that happening?
But you set the value as 11 hard coded.
Right, so what do we need to do? We need to take the current value and add one to it, right? So what's the current value?
Counter value.
Right, counter value, and I need to add one to it, right? So let's try this. Okay. Okay, now everything is working. Is that right? Right?
Yes.
Okay. Similarly, we can do it for a minus button. What's going to be the difference? We are going to subtract the value, right? So this button will also have an on click. And what's going to happen is, instead of plus one, we will be doing minus one. Right, now if I do, now it's subtracting and adding. So our counter is working perfectly for just changing one value. Anyone has any doubts till now? What happened? Should I explain again what happened?
वो const counter value वाला फिर से explain कीजिए ना.
Counter value. Okay. First thing, we need to use this React hook. Okay. So React provides it with some hooks that we can use. Where's the React documentation? If I can show you directly from their site. Yeah, React hooks. So this is something that, so when they were shifting from class components to functional components, there were a few problems that we were facing because of that. So React, they introduced something called as hooks, through which we can access this functionality. You don't need to understand that properly, but what it does is basically, when I call this function, okay, I need to pass it an initial state. So initially, whatever this value will be, okay? So start, I want to start it with 10, right? And then, you can relate this to, if you have done object-oriented programming, you can think of this as a constructor. Initially, I give it a value of 10, right? Then this is my getter and this is my setter. I think this made it very clear.
Yes.
So using this, I will only read the values. Either what I'm doing, I'm reading the value and this paragraph will show it out, right? I'm reading the value, I'm adding one. Okay, this is used only for reading. Then this function, setCounter, is only used for writing. In this, I need to pass the new value. As you saw, I had given 11. So whenever I click this button, what is it going to do? It's going to set the value to 11 by default, right? But what do we want? We want that the value should add by one. So first I will read the current value. And then I will add one to it. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. Counter value +++ in JavaScript, there's no like +++. JavaScript doesn't have that. Can you explain arrow and regular? Okay. Arrow and regular doesn't have any difference. I can write the whole thing similarly using a normal function also, but I can't write it over here in the line. I have to create a function. Oh, sorry. Const add value. I'm writing it in different way. I don't write it in regular. So function and then the name of the function, which will be add value. Then I pass it some parentheses. And in this one, I will pass our code, right? Right? And instead of doing this, I'll pass add value to it. Okay, now I'm not calling it, I'm passing the function. So whenever this onClick event will happen, it will then onClick, the handler will call your function, okay? You don't need to call your function. You're passing the function and then the code itself will call it, okay? So we will try this thing. This is in regular function syntax. It's working exactly the same. Okay, there's no difference, right? So this is just like syntax choice. I prefer to write using this format instead of in regular functions. You are free to write it in any way, okay? Right. Okay. Now, what we have done is technically correct. Okay, there are no issues in this. It's technically correct, but there is something called as memory leak that can happen. Okay. So if there are a lot of changes and React cannot keep up with those changes, so there might be something called as memory leaks that happen. Okay. So let's say right now the value is 16 and there are a lot of like clicks happening in this application. It's not going to happen. Sorry. In this application, it's not going to happen, but in other applications, when you're doing any big scale application, there will be a lot of changes that are going to happen simultaneously, okay? And in this, we are changing a value using its previous value, right? So what can happen is, as of right now, it's 16, and I click this button, it should turn to 17, but something might happen, okay? And someone else changed it to, let's say, 20, okay? And this one, when you're running, it remembered that it was 16, okay? So now you have like different data that's going on, right? So this is what you call memory leak. You don't need to understand very much, but basically you create race conditions, okay? So what do you need to do is you need to pass another function to this, okay? And I'll write another, so the code is going to be the same, okay? It's the same code, but I'm going to give it another function, okay? There's another function, but the difference is it will have a previous value. So inside these round brackets is a parameter that I'm passing. Okay, so previous value, and instead of using counter value, I'll use previous value. So what this is going to do? Okay, now you're not reading from here. You are reading that whenever this set counter value is called, it will check currently what is my value, and according to that, it will do plus one. Okay, so this will prevent your memory leak. Is this clear? It's going to work exactly the same. There's no difference. Code-wise, performing, it's going to be the same. It's just there are some whenever. So this is like a, you can think of it like a rule that whenever you are changing a value using its previous value, you need to write it in this way. And if you're setting it on its own, let's say you're changing from true to false, so that is based on some condition. So that is something that will happen regardless, right? So over there you can do. But if you're using the previous value, you need to write it in this way. Is this clear?
What's this tree value? Like it's a function or something kind of that?
So this itself is a function. Okay. I'll just put the brackets in. Okay. It's the same thing. It's just like it's one liner, so I don't need the brackets. Okay. But you can see this is your parameters. In normal function, you'll write this, right? Right? You pass parameters inside this, let's say, or you write a function called as add. And you pass like parameters A and B to it, right? And you then return C, you return A plus B, right? Same thing. You pass some parameters to it, right? Similarly, previous value will be a parameter that will be passed to it. Is that right? And arrow, and this is the code. I feel that this is a cleaner syntax. That's why I use it. You can write it in this way also. It's completely fine. No issues. Okay.
Hello. Sorry, but tree value should have some value in it, right?
Could you repeat?
Tree value should have some value in it, huh, from start.
Yes. Okay. So when you run this set counter value, okay. So the way this code is written, okay. So this is how React has written it, okay. Either you can pass it a value directly, which we were doing initially, right? Counter value minus one, it will create some number, barabar.
Yes.
Yes. And you give it to this one, and it will change the state. That's right.
Yes, go ahead.
Right. But if you pass it a function, the code can see the difference between a function and a proper value, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So if it sees that, okay, I got a function as an input, okay? So what it's going to do, it will give you the previous value in this, okay? You can choose not to use it also, by the way.
Okay.
You can just write it like this also, okay? It doesn't care.
Okay. But
we want the previous value, right?
Yes, to avoid a memory leak.
Yes. So it will check the current value by default. Okay. So instead of us accessing it from here, which can cause a memory leak, this setter will only itself check the value. Okay. So internally, React has put like safety against it. Okay. That memory leak won't happen.
Okay.
Previous value is not provided by use state. It is also use state. It will give you a function to update the state, and this setter, set counter value, will give you the previous value. Is that clear, Vivek?
Yes, Vivek.
Okay, you are Vivek. Okay. Right. So similarly, we are going to do the same thing for minus also, right? Minus, and I think I put an extra bracket somewhere. And plus plus, minus minus. So our code works perfectly. Understood? So this is how you handle state. So we covered that. I told right. React has only does only two things, and right. So React does two things, and it does these two things perfectly. One, it will render UI components. We saw how components work, right? This is the UI, right? And second, it will handle or it will react to data changes, right? So this is your data, and this is how you change the data, okay? So this will automatically, whenever this state will change, the value of counter value changes, and it will be reflected on your page, right? So this is how it works, okay? So this is your use state. Anyone has any doubt in this? Okay, I think nobody has any doubt now. All right, so now next, we saw that we have like some custom input also for values with a change curve with which we want to change it, right? So how do we do this? So this is just an input field, right? HTML, basic HTML, nothing complex going on over here, right? I cannot use previous value in another place except setters. No, yeah, right. The setters will do that. Okay, can you explain that memory leak part? Okay, basically if I will tell you what happens is if you're changing the value directly, okay, there might be race conditions that are happening. Okay, because it's reading the value of itself and updating itself. Okay, so there might be different calls. Like if I like spam this button, like I just click plus 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 plus, right? I'm calling that again and again. There might be some sort of race conditions going on where I might lose one or two calls. Okay, in this application, it's not going to happen, but in big applications, there are chances that it will happen. Okay. So what this does is when we give it in this format, we pass instead of a value directly, we give it a function that will check the previous value and then update it. Okay. So this one will prevent these race conditions and memory leaks. Okay. That's all you need to know. Like itna detail mein you don't need to understand how memory leak happen and like what problems can happen. Just know that this is something that prevents it. Okay, now next, we are first going to build this input field, right? Which will have the value. So this will be over here, a input field, right? Basic tag, and it will have a value of, let's say, one, right? And that's all. Let's see if it shows properly. Okay, so we have rendered it. Okay, one thing, I'll just change this to type of a number so that I get this plus minus for this. Okay. All right. Okay. Now, input. Okay, so basically input of this value will be changing. Yes or no? This property of input, the value in here, this will be changing, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So because it is changing, it needs to be registered in the state, right? So similar, we are going to make another state for the counter value, right? The change value, okay? Const. I'll not use snippets this time so that people who don't have VS Code or they didn't install the snippet, so they can also see that it's possible. There's nothing like different going on. Change value and set change value. This will be another use state, and I'll give it an initial value of one, right? And save. Okay, Now this thing, now if I try to change it, I'm typing stuff, but like nothing is happening, right? Why? Because I have hard coded the value 1 into it, right? So first thing what we will do, we want to read from this variable. So we will put a change value in here, right? And because we are writing JSX, we'll put brackets. So change value. Now it can read the value from there, right? So if it's 1 or 2, accordingly, right? Okay, next thing. So input has something called as on change. Okay, so it is similar to on click. What will happen in on click? Whenever you click, a function will be run, right? Similarly, whenever you change the value, I'm trying to change the value, but nothing is happening, right? How do I do that? I will use on change and I will pass it a function. I'll pass it a function, right? So I'll just see console log and I'll just say changed, right? We'll see, is this thing happening? Is it seeing that I'm trying to change things, right? Okay. I'm trying to type something. You can see that it is logging that, yes, I'm trying to change something, right? So we are sure that this thing will work, right? Okay, next thing. So whenever you are changing, it is an event, right? This on change, it is emitting an event, right? This is a change event. So this function will receive a parameter, something called as event. Okay, we will use the variable e for that event. Similarly, how we used previous value, right? Because a previous value was passed to it. Similarly, over here, an event will be passed. Let's console log that event to see what happens in that, what is in that event, right? I'll just try changing it. Okay. You can see there are so many things that are happening. I also don't understand most of them, but the important one is target. And inside this, there are so many things, right? But you can see there is something called as, inside target, there will be something called as value. And over here, I can see the value over here, right? Okay, so this is where our this thing is, values, right? Okay, so how will we update this? We will change using e.target.value, right? You're right. Okay. We'll console, we will e.target.value. Okay, I'll just clear this. And okay, you're seeing that I'm typing, but it's not changing over here. Why? Because I have still not changed my state, right? The value for this needs to be changed, right? So I need to set that new value. How will I do that? Instead of console logging, I will set it using set change value, right? And now if I see, now if I run this, okay, now I can change things, right? So now whatever I write in this input is being tracked by React, right? So whenever you are dealing with some forms, right, there will be different input fields, right? There will be two things that you always need to do. There will be value, which will have the value of whatever field it is. And second, an on change, in which you will set the value using e.target.value. All right. If it is file, e.target.files. That's different thing. We will do it in the social media application where we will upload photos. So over there, you will see how to handle files using React. Okay. So now we can see that, okay, now we are dealing with these things, right? Now we have these values with which we want to change the values, right? But if I want to change, it's still doing with one. Why? Because in our code, when we are updating, I've written plus one, minus one. So now what we will do, we want to do it according to the change value. So that's what we are going to do. Plus change value or minus change value. Okay. And you can see that I'm trying to do something and this is just going bizarre. Nothing is working. Okay. Now anyone knows why this thing is happening?
The e dot target dot value is a string.
Could you repeat?
It's string while plus while adding.
We need to
typecast it to a number.
Right. Okay. Okay. For people who didn't understand what happened. Okay. When we are dealing with input, okay, whenever changes is happening, this e dot target dot value, okay, this input, be it anything, it will only return a string to you. It won't return anything else. All right. So because I'm taking a string and then I'm trying to add it to a number. So what is going to happen is that you can see it appended it in the back, right? And when I'm clicking in minus, it is now it is a little understandable that it understands. Okay, we want to subtract. So in strings, there is no subtraction. So minus is working properly, but addition is not working properly, right? How do we solve against that? What we need to do is when we are setting this value, we need to typecast this string. So see, this is a string. It returns a string. We need to change it into an integer. So parse int. This is a pure JavaScript function. Okay. You pass it a string and it will return a number. Okay. So now let's save this and now try to run it. Now everything is working properly. Right. And let's say I change it to 5. And our application works properly. Right. Anyone has any doubts in this up till now? Till now, we have only discussed how state changes work. That's the only concept that we have done. Any doubts in this? And we understand how to do event handling in forms. Anyone, any doubt? Okay, I'll do one last exercise. Okay. So let's say, these values, okay, these values we want them to come from some database. Okay, I'll just set these values as default. Okay, 5 and 10. Okay, now let's say we want these values. Okay, right now these are just very simple numbers, but you can imagine that it can be some user profile or it can be let's say some posts. Basically they are all like part of state only, right? What is inside this doesn't matter. What's the value that it's holding doesn't matter. Basically, everything is just a state that we are tracking, right? Okay. Now, let's say that we want these values to come from a database. Okay. Database or backend or API, whatever. We are calling something and we are getting some values. Now, how do we deal with that? Okay. So, we are going to learn about a new hook, which is called as use effect. Use effect. Okay. So it has these three parts. Okay. First, we will import this from React because otherwise it won't work. Similarly, as we had to import use state, right? Okay. Now let's read the documentation. Okay. Use effect, it has two parts. It's a function, it has two parts. First part, it's an effect. Okay. Something will be running. And second part, it's a dependency list on what dependency or effect should be run, right? You will see how this thing is working in this example. And over the days, these two, use state and use effect, are the most used hooks. And as you use them, you will understand more. Okay. Okay. So first thing, some function, some effect that needs to be run, right? And second, dependencies. Okay. So this is okay. This you don't need to worry about right now. This we will deal tomorrow when we are dealing with to-do list. You will see that cleanup part. Only two things are required: a function that has some effect, and second, a dependency list. Okay. If there are no dependencies, you leave it empty. Okay. I would not, so this is basically optional, but right now don't worry why it's optional, why, just remember you have to put at least an empty array if there is no dependency. Now, effect. So as I said, let's say that we are calling from some database or a backend, right? So we will run some database calling. So first let's set up a ping data, okay? Fetch data. This is in your public folder, okay? Create a new file, okay? Called data.json. So this will be our mock database. And you put this value in it, which will have your default values of counter and change value, right? Is this clear? After I had to sometimes React disconnects with your development server, so you have to refresh sometimes. It's okay. It's okay. In my VS Code, empty bracket is not working. Okay, I think you have like made a mistake somewhere. So okay. I'll go again. So use effect itself is a function and it has two parameters. One is effect, which will itself be a function. Okay. And second, a dependency list, which should be an array. Okay. So first parameter is a function, right? And your second parameter, it should be a dependency list, a array. All right. So these are your two parameters. Dependency list, as of right now, it's empty. We will see how, what happens when there is a dependency, but as of right now, keep it empty. Okay, next thing. In this, we are going to run some effect. So we created this data.json file, right? So we are going to fetch that file, okay? It is similar if you're calling some backend or you are interacting with some database, okay? Fetch, we are going to run fetch. This is a JavaScript function, okay? Using this, you can call any file, you can call any endpoint, any URL, okay? Next, what it is going to do is, right, okay. Now, how fetch works, it's going to return a promise, okay? Because database calls can take a lot of time. This is some external application that you're waiting for, right? So you can't stop your program for something like this. So this happens asynchronously, okay? You are working, your program does not stop while it is fetching this, okay? Now, this one will give you a promise that yes, we will give you some value, okay? So once we receive that value, then there will be some response, okay? There will be some response. So this, it will require a function on fulfilled. Like if it happens, there will be a function that will be run. Okay. It's going to be a function which will have response. And what we are going to do is, okay, we are going to convert that response into a JSON, right? This is the first thing that we are going to do. Because we know that jo data aane wala hai, that's JSON. Okay. The data that's coming is JSON. Okay, next thing, once it is converted into a JSON, then I will do something. It's a function that will do something, right? Okay, what is it going to do? What we want to do is whatever value we get from this, right? The counter and the change value, okay? This will give you some data, right? What we are going to do is we are going to set the counter value. So counter value is our 10. That is going to be counter in this thing, okay? So data dot counter, okay? It's going to access this, and from that it's going to access counter. So this is how objects, you need to access object values in JavaScript, okay? Similarly, we are going to set our change value to data dot, what's the name, change value. Data dot change value. All right. And save. Okay. Sir, data dot JSON is inside public folder. Yes. It's in the public folder because we want to call it in this way. That's why I put it over there. We want to call it as like a endpoint. Okay. Right now we are accessing a file itself, but you can also access your this thing. Okay, let's say I'll just do it empty. Okay, one and one. Okay, by default there are no values, right? So what should happen when I come to this page, right? Initial value were 1, 1, right? But what happens is when I refresh the page, initially you saw for a moment it was 1 and 1. As soon as it got the response from the file, what it did was it set the values to our values that we received from the file, right? Initially it was 1, 1. I'll refresh the page again. Okay. Refresh 1, 1. And then once the file is received, whatever changes we got, we put over here. Got that? Similarly, if we are working with some database, right? We will receive some value from the database. Let's say it's a user profile. And we'll set the local state of your page to the value that we received. The profile, whatever it is, name, the photo, age, whatever, contact number. We will set all of that, right? So that is how it works. You go to any website. Let's say we go to this one, right? Where is it getting this version 14.17.6? It's getting from somewhere, right? It's calling from a database. What is the latest version? So similarly, we are seeing in our application that how whatever the value we want from our backend, we are setting it over here. Okay, I explained it in 2-3 ways. I hope you understood it. Data.json, okay. It's just an object, a JSON object, which has counter and change value. Yeah, you can use async await. That's also possible, but I will use this syntax. So our functions has like different way of writing. You can use async await also. That's also correct way of dealing with asynchronous, like fetch is an asynchronous function, right? So you can do async await with it. That's also possible. And last, if there is some error, you catch that error and you can do anything with that error. I usually just console log it, okay? So over here, you can do some error handling if the promise has some problem, okay? Okay, anyone has any doubts in this? Yes, source code, I will put it on GitHub and it will be sent to everyone on the WhatsApp groups where you will be able to access all of this. Okay.
So one second, can you come again?
Okay. Everything that we did today and in the future sessions, everything will be posted on GitHub. So you can look at the source code over there. Right. Right. Okay. If anyone doesn't have any doubts, we can end it. Anyone like Rasook, Delzine, Mohil, done.
Can you please summarize?
Can I like summarize? Okay. What all we did? Okay. And again, share the screen. Okay. What did we do? First, we understood like how React works. What it does, it takes a empty HTML file. Okay. It finds an element. Okay. And then the React DOM, which is a virtual DOM that React has. Okay. It will inject our code into the element that we found, okay? This root element is going to inject everything into it. All right, okay. The next thing, our component has two parts. One, a JavaScript part. Over here, we define all these states and the effects that will happen. Those kind of things we write over here. Some helper functions, all of that, okay? So all of this, we wrote it inline. We can even like extract this and create a function itself over here, as I showed earlier, right? And it's going to be the same thing, right? And we can just pass this function over here. right? And it's going to call it when onClick event will happen, right? This function will be called over here, okay? So you can do this way also. Instead of inline, if you want to keep the function separately, that's also possible. Maybe you want to reuse it again and again, okay? I should have named it differently, okay. And then you return some HTML, okay? This is what is going to be injected, right? And we learned how to handle state in a React. There is your useState React hook, which will give you a getter, a setter. Using getter, you can access the value of your state at that moment. Let's say we are printing it, we are showing it on the web page. So you can do it using this. Or some changes is happening and someone clicked it, you want to change the value. So this is how you're going to do it, right? There are two ways of setting. You give it a value directly, or you give it a function that using its previous value, it will update the value, right? Okay. Next thing we learned is a use effect, okay? This thing is going to run some code, okay? It's going to do some code. Usually it is database calling, okay? Usually we call database over here. There are a few instances where we do some other things also over here, but usually it's for like database calling, where whatever changes will happen, we will set it in our state. So this is use effect. Okay, these are like the things that we learned today. Anyone has any doubts in this? Show the async await version of the code. All right. So this same code, I will just copy this and I will, sorry. Comment this out. First things first, this needs to be an async function, okay? If you are going to use an await thing, then the function needs to be asynchronous, okay? Next, we await this thing. When we are fetching something, we will await this and we will get a response, right? Then next thing that we are going to do is we are going to await the connect, changing it to JSON. We are going to await this. And this will be our data. Okay. And I'll put this on the same. Okay, it wants to stay on the other line. Okay, can't do anything. And next, using this data, I can do these things, right? So these two lines, I'll just move them up, sorry, move them up. And this thing is not required anymore, right? And okay, next thing, we can do a try catch block around this for handling error. Try catch on error, console log the error. And this whole thing will be happening inside the try block. So this is the async await version. Data.json. Data.json just has, it's just a JSON object that has two fields, counter and change value. That's all. And you can put any value over here. I put 10, you can put 15. Accordingly, your values will change. As you can see, no issues. It's just like database calling. FTP, okay. How do I write to JSON file? Okay, writing, yes. So this will also happen through this thing only. What can happen is, let's say we click a submit button. So over here, let's say there was a submit button and instead of like on click, we are changing the value. So it's a submit button. So on click, some submit function will happen, which is going to interact with your backend. You can do, you can create a function itself. So how we are setting the values, over here you can make some calls to the data, your backend. Okay, that's also possible. So we will deal with all of that, like, you know, getting the values, changing the values with the backend interactivity. Tomorrow we are going to deal with to-do list. So over there we will deal with Firebase. Okay, it's a database. on the cloud. So using that, we will see how all of this will happen. Today, I was focusing on just the basics of React. Okay. Your use state, your use effect, how JSX works. If you want to put JavaScript inside HTML, you have to put the curly braces. Why is that? So all of that we discussed today. Okay, how to access any variable of component in another component without passing it as props. So that whole props part, we are going to deal with it tomorrow when we are going to make the to-do list. I didn't understand the question though, like what you were saying. Okay.
How to use the value from another component without passing it as props.
Could you repeat?
Using the context API.
Huh, okay, context API, we're going to deal with it in the e-commerce website because that you can think of like, okay. So these values, okay, counter value and change value, these are local to this component itself, unless you pass it down to your child. Okay, your child component, if you pass, then you can access it. But over there also like, okay, I'll explain all of this in tomorrow's session because that's where this whole, so basically React is kind of like a tree structure. Starts with the root, which is your app. Okay. It starts with this one and you branch it out into like different components. Okay. All of that we'll discuss tomorrow. But what you're saying, context API, that creates a different, it will be like a global state. So that state can be accessed through any component. You don't need to pass it through props. Okay. That's what it does. All right. We'll deal with that in the e-commerce website. Don't worry. After this 4-day session, I'm sure like anyone can make any like website they want as long as they have the styling skills, which I don't have. CSS you might have seen. I'm not that very good with styling. I'm not, but code I will help you to the like you can make any website you want functionally. All right then. If there are no more doubts, I will like end the lecture. All right.
Okay, so I'd like to give the vote of thanks. So on behalf of our college, KJSIIT, our principal, Suresh Ukrande, sir, vice principal, Dr. Sunita Patil, ma'am, and Professor Uday Rote, sir, and the entire team of CSI, I would like to thank you all for being such an interactive audience. And we're really honored that all of you gathered in such large numbers for our bootcamp. And we hope you learned something new today. So we'll see you all tomorrow as well at the same time. That is 3 p.m. for day two of the bootcamp. Ensure that you are filling up the feedback form in the chat box so that you all are eligible for the certificate. Thank you, everyone.
Guys, should I stop the meeting now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you all for joining. Now we are ending the live stream. See you all tomorrow.